as I said, a German, in fact, membrane contractor, and we worked with a local contractor for the steel production, who had little experience of lightweight structures, or in fact, a sort of the complex geometry that was required of a structure like this. And so, in fact, you can see this enclosure at the top here, this curved, what should have been curved section, which was drawn as curved in all the production information, went to site as a polygonal section ultimately. The steel fabricator unable to actually create a three-dimensional surface. All the connections, the detailing that we used for this, these heads of the mast here, we drew every single plate out in full size and, in fact, fabricated, made half-size models for them to give to the contractor to allow him to create the correct geometry. We worked, as I said, with Bodo Rasch on this project and Fry Otto, in fact, who has had a huge amount of experience, obviously, in membranes and particularly in moving structures. But this, the ability to be able to develop a moving structure like this has come from the work in previously in membrane structures and then starting to deal with some of these moving structures like the TSB unit. So you can see the fabric here driving over the lighting rig at the front. The stage itself, in fact, is the only part of this not covered. We're actually looking at the moment with Bodo Rasch, an extension or a series of canopies at the front which will cover the stage. But you can see the requirement then for moving what is effectively a huge sail, this is almost 2,000 square meters, deals with a whole series of different issues above and beyond that of a static structure. And we worked with Peter Heppel on this project who designed sails for the America's Cup. As the structure's moving out, the front edge of this becomes very, very sensitive to wind and can ultimately tear itself apart. So in fact, that front edge is weighted in a particular way to control that. And then the hanging system for the structure, you can see here the pickups up to the cable net above, are such that the membrane doesn't drop down to the level of the audience. Again, the fabric, you can see here, almost deployed and then finally deployed. Simple saddle surface again, same principle as the first canopy, on a slightly different scale, and much more complex in the detailing for the structure. We also work with Will Alsop on the engineering for this, the Cardiff Bay Visitor Centre. And it's interesting that when Will talks about the project, he's sort of slightly glib about the way the form of the enclosure developed. But actually there were a lot of conversations early on in the development about the requirement for this building to be moved from this site, which was its original location. And in fact, it was due to stay on the site for only 2 years because of the arrangements for leases, etc., on this particular site at Cardiff Bay. So the enclosure itself, and I won't go into very much detail about the structure, but the idea was to lift the building off the ground and leave as little in the ground as possible. So actually what we ultimately have is a structure which is supported off this center line here on just a series of frames, and then they're actually tied down to these strips just using standard turnbuckles on either side, so stabilizing the structure in place. And the reason for that was that almost a year ago now, we lifted it up off its foundations and moved it to a site half a kilometer down the bay. So again, the sort of dynamic, the form, had developed from a series of requirements which had obvious huge effect on the design, the architecture, but also on the engineering and that combination of the two. I spent some time in America with Mark Fisher working on Pink Floyd's set. And this is one element of the set, which is the mix position in the center, which was interesting for a number of reasons. The set there uses a 40-meter span arch, but the thing that I'm interested in is this mirror ball, which actually, the view you can see here, the enclosure is actually driven back on top of this the box, a framework, and the mirror ball itself climbs out of, on a mast, the base of that box. So you can see here the mirror ball as it begins to come out, and in that view, when the mast is fully erected. And this mast, which really is, it's a mast that we didn't develop actually, it's called a star lift, but it uses a triangular base, and then a series of bales. And these bales roll around a mechanism, which you can just see here. And as it folds, each of the walls of the truss closes in together and lock, so that actually what you do is build a mast out of a thing which is, you know, the size of a shopping trolley or something slightly larger. And you can create a structure 20-odd meters tall on which this mirror ball was suspended. So that's the kind of development of structure that one can allow the growth, the movement, the change in these structures. And this is a thing that obviously, again, you can see the kind of theatrical application of that when this thing grows out of the mixed position. That mirror ball, interestingly, is the biggest mirror ball in the world and is in the Guinness Book of Records. And this, we worked with a company in San Francisco and developed the mirror balls, in fact, from a series of leaves that you can see here. The mirror ball rotates, and during one of the sequences of the songs, they unfold like a series of petals. And then a large xenon light is used to run light around the auditorium. And here you can see in more detail, every leaf is controlled by an individual hydraulic. And we developed with them the hydraulic systems, the structure for the system, the mirroring itself, and the rotation systems for the mirror ball.
This is the theatre of architecture. I suppose the early inspiration of films like Metropolis and built on some of the ideas of the futurists, the Italian futurists particularly. And, you know, we're now, I think, beginning to find ways of enjoying the dynamic of structures that can be overlaid upon each other and can work in concert to make some extraordinary event. And these two slides are really just to talk about how architecture and this idea of a performance that makes a structure that's still, and now Neil picking up on some of these entertainment projects. The next project we just wanted to show was something that we did for Imagination, who you probably know, who are based around here. Their work for Ford has been going on for some years. In fact, many years ago, I used to work with them. That's the connection, really. We were asked 2 or 3 years ago now to work up with them design for a new exhibition system that would make its way around Europe and would actually have as its focus a performance, the launch of a new car, a new Mondeo. And we literally wanted to make around that performance. We wanted that performance to switch on the environment, to make kinetic architecture that would be focused on the center, would be focused on the performance, but would actually signal to a further audience in halls such as the Palexpo in Geneva, where we actually showed the first design. So we wanted to literally make a kinetic architecture, one that kept moving, and did so every 20 minutes the performance happened. We did this by building on some of the experience of the TSB structures. One of the requirements for environments like this is they actually are on a much bigger scale than, say, the TSB, but they don't. They may be 15 to 20 times bigger, even bigger than that. But they actually only have around about 5 or 6 days to build them. And we wanted to take to these places a very sophisticated architecture and system of display that was using fairly sophisticated software to, as I say, to literally switch itself on, to animate itself, so that this animation might be the form that would actually choreograph the movement that we wanted through the stand. And so at the same time as these wider, hopefully ambitious ideas, one really needed to take into account the fact that however big the crew, the limited amount of time was going to set a limit on how we actually got the structure into place. And so knowing that we could drive structures across Europe and they could be 2.4 meters wide and we could have loads up to 4 meters high, we could actually make structures, Veer and Deal bridge structures that already were clad in glass, that already had glass floors with their lights in place, that already had threaded through them the power to generate and the chains that actually drove canopies that we could sit on top of this structure, canopies that could slide across the structure and to turn around them. These were things that we were faced with overcoming those technical problems if we simply were going to deliver the idea, deliver the concept in the various locations. The slide on the left really sums up the family of elements that we designed. What we'd actually got here was the was these Veer and Deal, again, Veer and Deal trusses, Veer and Deal box girders, bridges, and their equivalent on the floor here. That, as I say, were already made with their trays for lighting beneath them so that we simply could just plug them in place. These that were made in sections, I think 2.45 sections long, that could be lifted into place with forklift trucks already with their glass floor, which you'll see in a minute, already braced and glazed at the end here, and with the chains and, as I said, the power to actually sit on top. These canopies here that at various times, according to when the performance began in the centre here, would actually slide across the top of the structure, so that these could actually signal to people coming into the hall from afar. At the same time, these plinths at the front for the stars of the show would also rise and tip and turn, so that these were also structures that were sort of that were in the wings, as it were, and would actually complement the performance in the centre. The route was actually encouraging this route as a story really of the technology that Ford were currently using and wanting to tell people about and show off. And so this was actually a sort of a route that took you into the heart of the stand and actually lifted you up across a bridge here, so that from the bridge you could actually view what was going on and then back down again and out, or access to a hospitality pavilion and offices, and by way of a central exhibition room on the top there. These structures here on the top are the roof structures for the hospitality pavilion, and in the centre, one of the reasons for this structure also growing and turning was some of the restrictions on how far we could build out from a balcony wall here. And so we managed to get approval for a structure that would appear and disappear at the culmination of the show every 20 minutes. Right in the center here, and this is what Neil will probably now pick up in more detail, was this stage show with this video screen. This video screen 12 meters long. And it was from here that we intended to sort of reveal the car and the models of the car. And as this lifted, this was a signal for the rest of the stand to animate itself and to kick into life.
Yeah, so it's interesting working on the types of projects and exhibitions. Again, there's this the whole condition that one designs for. It's different to that to conventional buildings. There are requirements to limit the size of elements, pieces that one can actually manhandle into place in very short spaces of time. And so the work with Lorenzo in this type of exhibition sort of overlapped very much with the work also we were doing with Mark in with Pink Floyd and the Rolling Stones, amongst others. And also this requirement to produce information which could then be used, which is one of the major parts of the work, to produce information for the design which can be used in almost any country, because a lot of these exhibitions here are European and they're used in a number of different locations. And the work we did with Mark Fisher, those sets are used worldwide, so we had to produce calculations which are effectively generic. So again, there's a whole another set of issues that one is required to work with, which is actually what's one of the things that makes each project specifically so interesting, not simply from an engineering design point of view, but the whole coordination and organization of a project. So this, as Lorenzo pointed out, had some of these ideas, this element here, which would slide backwards and forwards and suggest the beginning of a sequence of ideas, which was showing basically the idea of this structure was to launch the Mondeo. So the bridge developed, and you can see here, this is the view from the end of this bridge, and it spans across onto a series of supports. And then finally, here, it spans from this wall here across the video wall to the opposite side. And the reason for that completely clear span, which is not apparent in this picture, is this requirement for the wall to lift and the cars, which were robotically controlled, to move out from underneath the wall. And in fact, that is another interesting thing about this work. I mean, the first motor show that we actually did was in 1986 with Lorenzo. And there, the elements were very much about the physical nature of bridges, structures. And here, there was a subtle difference in the way it was worked. And actually, ultimately, the project was about computer control. And so it was interesting, the shift in the type of person that was working on it. So in the last few days of this project, there were actually people with terminals, computers sitting all over the set, over the stand. And that's very similar in the in Rock and Roll as well, with Mark, that actually each of the individuals working on the project for both Pink Floyd and the work we also did with the Rolling Stones, they're all computer hacks. And a lot of the work they do is sequencing the lighting effects with the sound effects with some of the show. So here you can see the glass floors and the movement around up, which takes you around a staircase up onto that bridge. And here the virandil is enhanced across the supports with bracing. And again, the ambitions are greater, but also the budgets are greater. So it's rather nice to be able to work with budgets that allow you to have these sort of enclosures with completely stainless steel detailing, glazing, etc., which is using a whole different type of glazing system and lighting beneath the floor. So here you get a view from the front, which is where the audience would stand when the show would effectively begin. And you can see there's a circular disc here which supports that canopy, which is here in its effectively closed position. And there you can see the video wall, which is suspended off the face of this virandil structure here. And there you can see that structure, the video wall itself, climbs up the face of that structure during the show. Excuse me. And the canopy above rotates, and there is a sort of lighting effect which is revealed so that ultimately the Mondeo, the final car, comes out from the center of that enclosure to great applause, no doubt.
This next project is a fairly recent one. It was finished in June, and it was a pavilion for the Hong Kong Tourist Authority. And what they wanted to do was to have a sort of their equivalent of a rock and roll tour, but telling people about Hong Kong as a place to go, as a destination. And as a destination, not just as a place for business, but as a place to holiday, or as just a location that one might extend one's business trip to actually take in some of the sites, and especially as part of the countdown to handing over the territory to the Chinese. And their idea at the time was to simply visit as many European cities as possible over a period of 3 years. The early ideas were they might actually have a sort of Hong Kong tram or bus or something and do that. And they went to a production company to ask their advice on the logistics of doing that and how many people they might actually be able to expose this idea to over the next 3 years, and the kind of environment that they might be able to build inside one of these vehicles. And we were approached by the same company to come up with a design. And our approach was to say, well, you know, Hong Kong is this wonderful, exotic place, but also it's a great modern city. And it's actually the juxtaposition of this colorful, exotic history of the place and this striding sort of modern metropolis that's actually what makes it a memorable place. And the inspiration behind it was everything from Foster's Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank and the idea of the junk sailing across the harbor in front of that fantastic structure, and also the idea of these fantastic scaffolding structures that one sees in Hong Kong, and also the colors of the silk and festivals, dragon festivals, and so on. So we were trying to make some structure that would actually say something perhaps less cliched about Hong Kong, but nevertheless deliver the same message, that is, make it, again, something memorable. And again, we wanted to build on our experience with TSB, but now going a bit further and making a space that actually, one of the problems with the TSB is however hard one tries, you know, to actually grow something of three times the volume of the original. We were quite pleased with it at the time, but nevertheless, they were still fairly modest spaces. And what we wanted to do now was to create a structure that could actually be the venue for some organized celebration, and in itself could actually be seen as a place that at night was actually a place, was a lantern within the city center. It was also seen as a building now that would actually go to the center of cities, so it might be in gardens and squares in the city, or in piazzas in the city. And so we came up with this this proposal. Now, having built TSB, we had certain confidence about how we could do it. And their brief was to make this structure, the production company's brief was to make this structure buildable within 24 hours with a small crew, up to six people. I'm going to forget the floor area, but I think it's something like 300 square meters of usable floor area, but that doesn't include the double height atrium space in the middle. This sequence of drawings at the top here just shows you how, very simply, the same principle as before, now with two trucks. And probably the most difficult thing that we actually had to do, I think, was just find a simple method of leveling and straightening and squaring up these two trailers. And once we'd done that, everything else seemed reasonably simple. But as you can see here, this is actually the first, this is what we proposed right at the beginning. In actual fact, the construction sequence as we developed the design, changed a reasonable amount. But this gets across the story, which is that the two trailers park, the trucks go off. They're leveled with a self-leveling system. The first one is put into place and draws the other one to it and squares it with structure underneath the floor here. And our first idea was that what we would do is then raise the two structures, and they're effectively sort of shoebox lids on top of the existing chassis, and raise them, and by raising them, allow us to then fold out half of the floor from one unit and half of the floor from the back unit, for the whole of this front here to be transparent, to allow a view into the center, and to allow the whole of the top floor of the structure to be connected by two bridges, then folded out and slung across the structure, and using the bridges to brace the structure. And the whole of the ground floor, the rear unit, to now be the service part of the building. With that in place, we could then flip out from the front a terrace and build on a ramp here, and then sleeve over the whole of the structure a membrane that in turn could then be pulled up and stressed by these canopies over the front here. And these are the canopies that are keeping off the heat gain, keeping it away from the building, and also signaling the presence of the building now at a higher, from afar, and allowing us to build some sort of element that would announce the building itself. So here, these are the early sketches of how we saw this happening with the ramp entrance. And a way through into this main entrance here, and the transparency that actually shows you that, you know, you are welcome and invited up to the top here, but On your way in, you're actually taken through a journey through the depth of the plan, and then eventually up to the top here. And from here, this is where you're subjected to. Sorry about that. That's back to front. I suppose that's changeable. Is it this one? Actually, they both are they? No, just this one. Just this one. That's it. And these are the first drawings, in actual fact, of getting that across. And you'll see from the photographs that we tighten this up just a little bit. And that was a result, really, of starting to pack all of these floors into the building, into the structure here. But you can see that the intention was that the ramp for all access now up onto this raised terrace with a entrance canopy here, with sliding doors, automatic sliding doors, and you'll see that really as the budget starts to kick into place, things like automatic sliding doors start to sort of drop off the project list. But nevertheless, the same principle of transparency there, with a reception area, a waiting area, and a desk, and then a long screen that would actually route you into the main sort of belly of the space here. And this would be via a series of display panels and introduction to Hong Kong, with a video wall at the back here. And that video wall, the back of that then is all the service space of the vehicle, with space for generator, kitchen, and so on. As you come through here, then the idea was there might well be a model of Hong Kong, various graphics panels, and eventually up to this. This is the raised part of the trailer now, and this would be the raised part of the trailer here. Up a spiral stair, and just again visible from the front here, up to the first floor. And from that first floor, this is a place for sitting and a meeting with a representative, and probably booking some trip, and certainly finding out more about Hong Kong as a destination. And the service stair at the back here. Again, with a dumb waiter for hospitality. The original sketches of that, the way through here from the entrance desk here, and the graphics wall and the bridge connecting the two with display panels, and the view from the top. And here you can see the membrane right at the beginning. Again, the brief was the building would actually travel around Europe, but would be two-thirds of the year. Now that makes quite a difference because, again, the lightness of the structure and its insulation, really one was concerned more with keeping the heat out rather than keeping the heat in. And later, or fairly soon actually, once we'd won the project, the brief changed. They really wanted it to be a building that actually could go anywhere at any time. So it may well be halfway up Mont Blanc in the winter and in the heart of Seville in the summer. So that led to the membrane are becoming a double skin membrane, an inflatable membrane that would allow us to give more insulation to that whole skin, but at the same time cut out the large amount of natural diffuse light. So you'll see that the solution then was to build into that double membrane three roof lights, and those roof lights would allow us also to open up the center of that space in the summer to actually encourage a chimney effect for warm air through the structure. And this is actually the plan of the structure as we built it. So again, the ramp and the terrace here, now just a simple hinge door, but the reception and the desk here at the front, and this moon gate through to a much more sort of literal exhibition of Hong Kong, which was something we resisted, but nevertheless the client felt needed to sort of be a rather more literal presentation. But then through to a space here which is used for seminars and evening presentations and so on, where the desks are on wheels to be able to be rolled and used as lecterns, up the staircase here and up to the back with the same arrangement on the top. So that's the view of basically what we built.
So again, it's expanding on those ideas and trying to employ materials appropriate to the requirements, and the major requirement here is obviously to be able to move it very, very quickly. So the two trailers, very similar in nature to the previous version for the TSB that we showed earlier, but the enclosure between, as Lorenzo described, formed by using low-pressure inflatables. And that, again, developed, we've done a lot of work with high-pressure inflatables on the Pink Floyd tour. The surface of the screen at the back of the set was supported by high-pressure inflatable tubes, and so we've been looking into the use of membranes as inflatables. And this not only provided a very simple means of stressing a membrane across this enclosure, but actually providing a level of buffer between the external environment and the internal, so that we could actually pump warm or cool air through that zone between, dependent upon the situation the structure is in. The whole, again, for lightness, the structure is actually constructed in aluminium, and the form of the membranes across the top are such that once they're pulled into tension, they enhance the stiffness of the membrane across the enclosure, the inflatable membrane. That shows a view internally beneath one of the bridges, and you can see that's one of the inflatable sections there with this central roof light, which provides the light because of the number of layers of fabric. We were using, trying to incorporate as much as possible the structure within the requirements of the building. So these bridges, which actually allow you to move around between the first floor's zones on either side, actually provide the restraint for the two units against the membrane forces being applied, which was otherwise just pull in. So again, it's this sort of layering of use, so things that are required for movement around the building also providing the structure for it. You just get another view from up at higher level of that same, of the membrane and the enclosure. And finally, just a couple of views of externally with the very simple detailing for the aluminium work, which again, all once the structure was enclosed, this whole thing had to go within the trailers that remained, and there was one support trailer which also housed the power units and amongst other things, and some level of storage for the additional elements that couldn't actually be supported in the enclosures of the two trailers, standard trailers. And it's interesting, this project, same production company, we worked very much at the same time, following on slightly from this one and another unit for Philips, which actually went on and uses four trailers. And so we have four trailers formed in a square. So you have the same problem of how to locate the trailers one to the next. And then that uses a membrane suspended in tension across the center of that square created. The structure, the external structure of the masts is supported from the trailers themselves. We have no slides of that, but that's a project that's being almost complete.
This is the final project. This is for a bridge that we were invited to participate in a limited competition for a new bridge, 170-meter pedestrian footbridge in the Royal Victoria Docks in Docklands. And we today have shown projects for ephemeral architecture that appears and disappears. But I think that the point about it is that it is the way it is because of that particular brief, and our interest doesn't lie solely in the architecture of theatre and entertainment and so on. But it is interested generally in lightness. It is interested in transparency. It is interested in invention, even though, one can sort of make a very convincing argument, that in architecture one rarely invents completely. One really rather modifies ideas that have been around, ideas and models and problems that have been around, solutions to those problems that have been around for centuries. One rather sort of builds upon those solutions. The inspiration really for this bridge, the bridge is actually located in Docklands. It's very close to the short takeoff and landing airport, Stal Airport, there. And the runway runs across, perpendicular to the direction of the to the bridge, the location of the bridge. And so the proximity of light aircraft, and I really mean light aircraft, mostly sort of 12 passenger, up to 20 passenger aircraft, was clearly something that was the context of the building. But in any case, we wanted to make this light structure that would float very lightly and would be seen as an object that may well have landed in its place and actually acted as a bridge across the across the dock, but may well actually take off or may well be put somewhere else. So it's actually a sculptural piece, and it's a machine in itself. And also, we felt that this location wasn't a location for a monumental structure. We wanted something that you know, in effect, could just sort of hover or slide across the water. And these two slides are a way of just putting some kind of form to those early ideas. This is the aerial view of it, and here we're viewing the thing from south to north. And I'm afraid we don't have any slides of its site location. So just to explain it a little bit, it actually is along this very long. It's the longest sort of dock in Docklands, the Royal Victoria Dock, and it's actually the location now for a sizable new exhibition centre development, and eventually the University of East London and various other more public development projects on this side of the dock. And they are connected to the Docklands Light Railway, which runs north of it. So there's actually, I think, Custom House station up here. And to the south of the dock, there's actually a very large now housing project. And that housing project has a route through it to a new park located to the south of it. And that park is a park it sits on the banks of the Thames and is actually near
the Woolwich Barrier. Yeah.
And so what this bridge is for is to connect all of this public activity and the connection to the infrastructure that's already in place now to all of this housing that's going to be built here, but also to connect it through to this riverside park to the south. And it so happens that all of this development over here is plan square, orthogonal to the long line of the dock here. And because of a change in the geometry here, the geometry of the housing is actually skewed, and is skewed off of square here. And the site that we were asked to span from was actually at a sort of obtuse angle across the dock, and actually culminated on this side in a crescent that was surrounded by housing on the upper floors and public spaces and shops and restaurants and so on the ground floor, and it was seen as a piazza space. And because of the nature of the dock, there's lots of activity on the water here, water sports, the structure needed to be at least 11 meters off of the water line, and we had to develop two designs, one fixed and one opening. And in fact, we haven't got slides of the opening version, but Neil will probably explain it in more detail. But this one actually saw the same form working for both options rather than two radically different options, with the whole of this side being able to open to let large vessels through, large vessels that would normally only be let through as part of some bigger exhibition within the exhibition centre that they had in mind. So what we were doing was we wanted to make a structure that was seen to float off of the water as much as it could, so it could actually be lifted up in the air. And it was also a structure that was actually a destination in itself. So the location of this bridge for across a very active dock here was seen as a place where, you know, from the bridge, one could actually orchestrate the activity of the dock. And in needing to do that, we felt what we needed to do was to create an environment that was not just about the shortest route across here, but was also a place that one could come off of the route down to an undercroft. We have designed here then a structure. It's like a boomerang. It's actually ramped up, a very small ramp, a very shallow ramp, 1 in 20, along the whole length of the site, coming together in the middle here. lifting so that their 11-meter limit here would allow us to sling from underneath the structure an undercroft which has the architectural character of a pier, so that one would find nooks and crannies under this undercroft that were actually points that that from which you could either see the sunset or see a race started, or on which one might locate kiosks for particular events that might go on in place. So what we wanted to do here was to create a sculptural form, a light architect, light and dynamic form, but also the field for building temporary structures within it. And incidentally, solve some of these problems of orientation, so to resolve through its geometry this shift from the orthogonal starting point of this architecture and planning to this sort of skewed geometry of the south bank, and to, through that, to make a high-level connection which was asked for potentially to the exhibition centre and through with a pedestrian link to Custom House, and to find ways that the fairly complex structure that made this work could actually express itself through the architecture here. So this is a sort of bowed truss that's drawn together by this structure underneath its belly here. And where we connect and where we go to the ends here is where we've expressed the way we've strengthened the architecture and the structure and given it architectural expression. At the end here, the simple connection then in those piers is to two lifts and a glass enclosed staircase, so that at night these could act again as lit beacons, which are entrances to the structure, with the underbelly of this lit strongly, and then this glowing as a beam structure.
I think more than all the projects that I've worked with Lorenzo on, this is the one project that made me realize that in fact engineering is only a very small part of architecture. And I think there are groups of engineers, I think, particularly in the world of bridge building, bridge design, who believe that bridge design belongs to engineers. I think this is a piece of architecture, and the engineering for it is clear in that it's sort of developed out of a series of architectural requirements, one meeting the desire lines of the site, which gave the shift to the bridge. And what we did was use a standard trussed section for the bridge, full depth, which you can see in the elevation. And then, because of this, the rise that was required or was used to allow this space underneath for these areas that one could go to sit and relax, look at the views on the water. We were able to then enhance that structure because of the shift, which we were required to do, with this offset bowstring, which is the thing you see there. The offset bowstring then became an element that was able to help suspend the walkways underneath. So there's, again, this whole series of layers that one can apply. And obviously, in conversation with the engineers when we were judging the competition, you know, they could say, well, it isn't the most straightforward way of engineering the project. Well, obviously not, but actually there are a whole series of other things going on with the project. The things, as Lorenzo pointed out, so very simple truss, really, with a bowstring, but just shifted. That then, when you come to the support conditions, two intermediates in the water and the end conditions, you're required, because of the way the forces move around, to stiffen effectively the structure locally or provide additional support or structure which will allow those forces to translate down to the piers. And that was dealt with by wrapping the enclosure itself, the structure, in steelwork, in another layer of cladding, which became a very stiff, strong box, which allowed those forces to focus down the support. And then that, in turn, at the ends, formed these ends to the bridge, so that actually you provide a series of pair of balconies, one at either end, which are then enclosed and are defined by this structure as well. Might have been another slide there. So you can see here the underslung structure and this idea of using the bridge as something more than simply a routing across across the bay, and this offset bowstring. In fact, we didn't win the competition, but I think it's not there. So that's the last slide. Thank you very much.
Yeah, as usual, we'll go up to the bar. So if anyone wants to ask Neil and Lorenzo any particular questions, I'm sure they'd be very pleased to answer them over a drink if you buy them a bottle of beer. Okay, thanks very much. I'd like to say thank you very much to Neil and Lorenzo for a very interesting lecture. Thank you.